Greetings. So we are in The Hague in Netherlands. I'm here with, together with Brother Kevin Roberson, who I would describe as a media warrior. And I have a question that I'd like to ask on behalf of my sons, Pitira, Siabonga, and Ofwe, who are all working in the cultural industry and are looking for ways to keep an honest and uncontaminated voice. And at the same time, they need the resources and to be able to raise and earn some money from the work. I wanted to ask Brother Kevin, what has been his experience in doing this? How do you retain an honest and truthful voice when you want to talk about issues that are seen as controversial and difficult, and still be able to live from it, make a living from it, and not sell out? Brother Kevin.
The first thing that I did was obtain an education, papers that show that I studied journalism, and I attended the University of Minnesota, Murphy Hall School of Journalism, and got a degree in journalism specifically focused on broadcast journalism. The reason why this is important is because then you can show the system that you started something and you finished it. And it's, nobody asked me for my transcript or my degree. They don't want to physically see it. But just the fact that I'm able to say that I have it is of utmost importance. So during school, it was also very hard for me to continue studying because, you know, I saw my other friends that were being successful. I was often the only person of color in the classroom. So I was like, you know, why am I wasting my time here? Why don't I just go get a job? Why don't I just go work and make money and better my situation like that and, like, forget the school thing? But I'm so happy I stayed and I stuck it out and I finished school and I was able to walk across stage and accept my degree. One thing that my faculty advisor said, Ken Stone, was that I shouldn't be pigeon-toed and I shouldn't focus on black issues. Because he said that would be something that would happen once I went into the media industry. After graduation, I sent out over 200 resumes, and I didn't get one interview. I was able to fill out one application, and I think they did that in, as far as the standards, the requirements for affirmative action in the United States, to show that they're receiving applications from people of color. I was never invited on an interview. When my faculty advisor said that he was in contact with the news director there, that I was one of the final candidates. And I was like, well, if that's the case, why didn't they invite me for an interview? So then I fell into a somewhat of a depression. I began feeling sorry for myself and was like, you know, why is nobody giving me a chance? I did end up writing for a website called examiner.com. And so I really wanted to focus on television, but then I was doing more writing when that was actually one of my weaknesses. So never be scared to venture outside of your comfort zone to be able to build up experience, and so that you're at least doing something within the media versus doing nothing at all. So in 2011, I moved to the Netherlands, to Europe, and I was still in the somewhat of a depression, feeling sorry for myself. I began picking up the pieces of my life by working in a warehouse, just having some type of form of income. Then I was introduced to someone who had a, we call it an uitzendbureau, a temp agency that worked within the media, and they were able to place me at a company called Dutch View, where I worked as an audio technician. So I wasn't working within my field, but I was working within making television. Then I left that job because I still wasn't doing what I wanted to do and bought my own equipment. I bought a secondhand camera, a Canon XH-A1. It came with a microphone. I got a tripod and I began using the skills that I learned in school, what I was educated with. I got Final Cut Pro, I got a MacBook Pro, and I began making my own contacts within the community and focusing on black and brown issues. And so when I was working at Dutch View, I saw how my colleagues, my white counterparts, they also had their own companies. So, and it was very easy for me to also set up my own company and to become a real freelancer. So I started my own company called Medea Media, and I was able to, you get a number from the tax agency, and then you describe what your function is. So it was a journalist, a media professional. So I began forming. I finally began believing in myself and forming the identity, my true identity, and focusing, honing in on my talents. After some situation at Dutch View, when I was working as an audio technician, they wanted me to continue working on a new project, but they didn't want to pay me for my work. And they said I should see this as an investment into my company. But how I saw it, it was an investment into their company. It was at a top soap opera, or soap, a Dutch soap. And they were being paid for my work. It was being broadcast on national television. And I was like, well, why am I not getting paid? So I ended up leaving. And that's when I purchased my own camera, secondhand. And I began focusing on the talents that I was taught when I was in school, as far as how to use Final Cut Pro, how to do a stand-up, how to position my camera, how to edit, how to arrange interviews, what questions to ask. And I began, I pushed the advice I got from a faculty advisor aside, and I began to focus on issues that also affected me, and that's
Black
issues. And my goal is to give our people a voice, because we are the ones that need to give ourselves a voice, and we need to use our talents and not allow ourselves to be oppressed and to be treated as second-class citizens. And we need to believe in ourselves. So I began making contacts within the Black community in the Netherlands. I began going to demonstrations. I began weaving my way into the community and building up trust and giving a proper platform to a community that is often, that is treated as second-class citizens, even here in the Netherlands. And what happened is a whole new world opened up for me. I refuse to work for the mainstream media, because before I even leave locations where I'm reporting a story, the mainstream media is bringing out stories filled with lies when I have the footage to prove that they're lying. So why, at first it was my dream to be an international correspondent for CNN, but then as soon as I saw this manipulation of the facts, I knew that that shouldn't be my dream, and that we need to have our own media, and that there is a way to do this, especially with social media. Instead of looking at what I didn't have, I looked at what I did have. I have YouTube. I have 5,000 friends now on Facebook. I have a Twitter account. I'm able to edit my own work and place this on the internet. I began looking at lectures that the founder of Vice gives about how they use a media online platform versus a television platform, and that's the wave of the future. I began shooting exclusive footage because I had access to these communities that the white media does not have access to. So now the media calls me. They call me for sources. They call me for footage, and then I can demand what the price is. I have, because I have the broadcasting rights over this footage, I can demand how they use this footage. If I feel that this is not a good situation, then I don't give them the footage. And money is not going to buy, they're not going to be able to buy my soul. My integrity is not for sale. So if there's a situation where I feel like they shouldn't be using this footage and if they're going to manipulate the story, I don't sell it to them. And because money isn't real. There's no gold standard anymore. So like, what are we really buying into as far as focusing on becoming rich and having large amounts of money? Like we're going into a system that doesn't really support us and support our culture and our group. And being in control of the media, of the information, it's empowering. And it scares the white establishment when we have our own media. So that's why there's no time to be afraid anymore. And fear, it's only a feeling. And you need to continue and work side jobs. Go work in a warehouse. Go work somewhere in the fields. Like, it doesn't matter. Go work somewhere where you're able to obtain a little bit of money, so you're able to buy food and pay for your shelter, but you're still able to focus on what your real talent is, and that's being a media professional. And go after the stories. Don't wait for something to come to you. Go to it. And just don't be scared and believe in yourself. I constantly get attacked when I'm doing stories here by my white counterparts, from saying that I'm a donkey, that I'm racist, that I'm not a real journalist. I am a real journalist. Someone else is not going to define who I am. I define who I am myself. And I know that there's enough people within the community that do support what I do and that are happy that I'm here, because there's no one else.
Wow. Skip things.
I get a little emotional because like it's real out here, man. Like we don't, like this is it. Like we're on the front lines.
True.
Especially here in Europe. And nobody's coming to help us. We gotta help ourselves.
Give thanks. Welcome home. Welcome home. We want to see you in Azania this year.
I'm gonna come. I'm gonna be there. I'm gonna raise my own funds, and I'm working on an independent project. And I'm gonna come see y'all.
Give thanks.